Please join me in welcoming Joy Harjo.
I'm going to read two scenes from my play, Wings of Night Sky, Wings of Morning Light. The protagonist, Redbird, meets Sunny at a howling contest at a 49. She learned he was from the stars as they hid from police under a bush. She soon leaves to join him in the stars to escape her rough life. I was happy as I made a home around the kitchen table in Sunny's world. Up here in the stars, we had our first baby, and she was beautiful like him, with a soft light from her dark amber skin. Sunny loved her as my father loved me. I was happy except for one problem. Sunny and I quarreled. It was over his tree. This wasn't any ordinary tree. Sunny's tree was shimmering with delicate flowers, the color somewhere between sunrise and a hickory fire flame. Her scent was sweeter than falling in love sweat when she sang her sad refrain. Sunny forgot about me. I was immediately jealous of that tree, and I had the sense that she was jealous of me. If you touch my tree, Sunny warned me, you will never get to go home again. But his warning didn't change the way I felt about his tree. Then I got pregnant with a son. The birthing was hard. He pushed, my body pulled. We went back and forth between sky and earth. I began dying. My grandmother found me in the after-death realm as I stood at the entrance to my family's encampment. Go back, Redbird. It's not your time. Your babies need you. She pushed, and after she pushed, our stolid boy found his way into the world with us. After our son's birth, Sunny left us nights to stay with his lover, his tree. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't cry tears. Sunny's tree lushly bloomed, exuding her flowering musk. I began looking for a hole in the sky for a way to leave. Tree began singing and calling out to me. We were both lonely. I want to see the children play. We became like sisters. We became friends. One morning I was uneasy, strange. The baby was teething and cranky as I gathered him up to take him out to the tree. I dressed my daughter in her favorite dress, made with ribbons, all the colors I was missing from Earth. She danced and played as we walked out to the tree. Sunny's tree was sad. She sang to me. I followed starlight just like you, and then he changed, or maybe it was me. I was an earth girl in a sky world. It wasn't working, he turned me into a tree. He'll plant and bury you as he did me to make you stay. I'll help you live. Pull me up beneath my roots, you will find a way home. Save yourself and your children, to know you're free will make me happy. It was the hardest thing I'd ever done, but I pulled her up. Sunny heard her cries and came running. I tucked the babies under my arms and stood there at the edge where her roots now dangled. He grabbed us, and I tried to pull free. It was then I heard my mother's voice at the bus station, sing to wake up the power, sing. Yay, yay, ee, yay, 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 ee, yay, yay. Yay, yay, ee, yay, 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 ee, yay, yay. My mother's song flew out and wrapped me in its arms. Sonny slipped his grasp and we flew free. We fell and fell and fell, flying through the hole in the sky. We flew through time like Manawa on his black horse. My two babies were soon grown. They branched out on their own, and though we made it through difficult years, something was wrong. I was still falling. One part of me speaks the sacred language of fire. The other part understands in broken heart. My mind can't make up its crazy mind. When I'm burdened by rain clouds of desire, falling, 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 falling. I didn't want to make the same mistakes. I had to find my own bright star. Touch my skin and I want back in again. Don't leave me here inside alone. Falling, 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 falling. I lost everything for love. I had no place left to go but home. I went to find my mother. I went to her door. No one answered. The keeper still had his hold. The danger with evil is it becomes habit. What can I do? I asked Spirit Helper. She answered, if you can't talk to your mother in person, you can talk to her spirit. I invited my mother's spirit to come and speak with me. Then, before I knew it, there sat the spirit of my mother. My mother, my mother. She smelled of tenderness. She smelled of love without question. I wanted this feeling forever. My mother's spirit moved to go. But why, I asked her, why can't I come home? Why? I begged without a rag of pride. Did you keep him and not me when I told you what happened? You need to know this, her spirit said. I dreamed a daughter who wanted to be born. I'd been up writing songs all night at the kitchen table when you appeared to me. I saw you first as a baby and then with fat cheeks, and then there you were, a grown woman, just like you are now. And I ask you then, why come into this kind of world? This is not a good time. But your intent made a fine, unwavering line that connected your heart to mine. My mother's spirit stood up to leave. I called after her, "You're going back to him. Do you love him more than me? More than all of us?" Then she was gone. Spirit helper said, "There are some things that take an eternity to understand."
Thank you all so very much, and we have just a few minutes left in this portion of the program, and so I will be watching the time because unfortunately it's somewhat limited, but we have just a little bit of time built in to have a conversation with Joy, which is an extreme pleasure of mine to be sitting here on the stage with such an incredible performer. I think I'm a playwright myself and have been dabbling in that in the last several years. And it's just an incredible challenge to get our stories out into the world. And what Joy has created in both her poetry and her music and her playwriting, it stands it's a powerful work on its own, but it's also paved the way for generations of younger Native writers, Native women writers, to come and follow in her footsteps. And so it is with a great deal of gratitude that I sit here on the stage with you right now. And I think the first question I just want to ask is, I know what we just heard was Wings of Night Sky, Wings of Morning Light, which is an amazing one-woman show that will be published soon, if I'm correct. And so maybe you could speak about that, because folks here will be able to purchase that book, or it'll be published, and so maybe you can give the details.
Okay, thank you. Well, this is Mary Kathryn Nagle. She's not just dabbling in writing plays. She is writing plays and performed at Manahata in New York City. So that's. Anyway, yes, this is play, a one-woman show that Native Voices of the Autry put on about 4 or 5 years ago and in Los Angeles. And then the Public Theater promised to produce it, and then it didn't get produced. So Wesleyan University Press, I have a deal with them right now. I'm writing another play that will restore Southeastern Native peoples to the origin story of blues and jazz. That's one I'm working on right now. So this play will be published probably in about a year with Wesleyan University Press, and will be available then. People have asked about an audio or video with it, but we haven't gotten, that's another whole story. Anyway, I'm really happy to be here at NMAI and to be part of this gathering, and it's just been amazing to hear all the speakers, just inspiring, because I think a lot of us, we work alone or in our communities, but to come together like this and I'll be hearing these voices and seeing all of you, as I work. There was one quote by John Barles that Brenda Child brought up, who is a professor of law, who says, stories express the law of aboriginal communities. And I think that's really true, because I think you can take almost any Native piece of art, whether it's a basket, a story, a song, and use it to speak about law. You can talk about the history of a community, the jingle dress, for instance, that was also part of that. Or, even the way of process, law process in a community, the way the minister also spoke eloquently about. You can find all of that in the stories. And the stories, whether they're plays or spoken stories, they're all stories.
One thing I'm interested in, and some of you I know, I've seen a few of our very talented Native performers sitting here in the audience today who have performed. Abby Yabara was sitting in the back. He's performed at the Public, and I see Rosie around here. She's an amazing dance choreographer. We have a lot of talent in our performing arts community. But it has been it has been a challenge to get our stories performed. You know, most of these theaters, like the Public Theater, that did a workshop of Wings and didn't fully produce it. We're not really sure why, but they don't. They haven't. The Public Theater's never fully produced a Native playwright ever in the history of their theater's existence. And when you think about all the other races and ethnicities that they've produced, which is important, we have such a diverse country here in the United States, why can't they produce one Native play? And that's a huge question I have. And having worked in the field myself, I know a constant challenge is this, and I'd love to hear your thoughts, Joy, on what this challenge is for you and your work, is writing from that place of truth where you're just honestly expressing yourself and your characters, but also keeping in mind, who is your audience? Are you writing for the Native women who are going to hear Redbird's voice and identify with that? Or do we have to change it slightly so that the white man sitting in the audience will say, oh, that story resonates with me, and that's the story I want to put on my theater stage? Because they're inherently in conflict. They just are. And so how do we as Native women writers write our stories, but also ensure that they're going to have a place in the American theater canon or in other arenas where Native women have yet to fully be invited?
Well, that's a large question that would take a long time to answer. But ultimately, of course, people, you know, I'm always astounded at people will ask, you know, after I perform or something, well, do you draw on your, what do they always say, in your Native heritage or whatever? And I says, well, does Philip Roth draw on his Jewish, you know, it's like, of course everybody draws on where they're from, and, you know, that's just a given. But it always seems, I think it comes from, as what you were talking about, red face, it goes back to those images in which, you know, basically Natives have been disappeared, and then where are the Native women? And it goes all the way across through, you know, in theater, most plays, there, you know, hardly any plays are produced, period, by women. And you think about Native women, we've talked a lot about the struggle to get our work out there. And then how much do you have to change it? I write because I don't think I was a natural writer at all. It came to me. I wanted to be a painter. I didn't want to sit and talk to people. And, you know, I wasn't a word person at all, but the spirit of the words, the poetry came to me and just said, you're coming with me. And it's like, no. But, you know, when those things happen, you have to follow them or your life will not go in the direction, you know, it goes. And you realize that you're here to serve. These stories, I carry them, who knows where they all come from, you know? It's they're given. And so I take care of it. And of course, at the center, you know, I'm going to quit saying you knows. Okay, at the center, I'm a Muscogee Creek woman, Cherokee too, from my mother's side, and it does go through the mother, but I've always had this close, my father's people, I'm enrolled with Muscogee Creek. I'm also an aunt. A lot of my work in life has to do with being an aunt, a mother, a grandmother, a soon great-grandmother. So that's crucial. We have stories, there's stories. And so the responsibility is first there, but then we want to get the stories out. And I'm thinking about, what about theater in our communities? What about, how do we move theater into our communities? Yes, it would be great to get a play produced, but we've run through the same, any Native playwright, writer will tell you the same thing, that often, it's difficult to translate between the two. Not always. I think a good story is a good story. But I know in writing, and the play goes through, I just wrote changes even before, you know, I came on. It's always, you're always revising. And when you're writing a play, you bring in a dramaturg who goes over the play. And we both know a wonderful Shirley, what's her name? Shirley Fishman, a wonderful dramaturg, very respectful, and really cares about our stories. But even then, she would bring up things, well, you can't say BIA, because who in here knows, you can't assume that people are going to know the Bureau of Indian Affairs. So you have to change that. But it makes it hard in the dialogue when the character who's just speaking like this has to, instead of saying BIA, they have to say Bureau of Indian Affairs. That's a small one. There's other things. There's the there are larger concepts that, you know, may translate, may not. But I know that if I'm reading a Jewish work or Jewish American, there's a lot of concepts that overall, thematically, that I might not be intimately involved with, but I look things up. And I think it's the same way that should happen with Native people in Native theater.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And it's certainly, I think, a lot of the younger Native playwrights coming up and trying to enter the world, it's something we struggle with every day and are navigating every day. But another question I have is, music is so incredibly integral to your performance and to your work. And I'm always interested in hearing even, you know, how other writers' processes, but other artists' processes, how do you make your art? And I'm really curious to hear about your process. Does in a piece like Wings, does the music come first? Or do the story, does the words come? Do different songs come at different times? I mean, how does your material, you know, generate, and how does the music and the spoken word fit together?
Every project is different. And I've been working for some time on this play called We Were There When Jazz Was Invented. It's actually about teen suicide also, or late, early 20s. And it starts with a young Muscogee Creek man on top of a large, tall building in Tulsa who's about to jump. He's just lost the love of his life, his girlfriend, who is a wonderful singer, to a heroin overdose. And he's a musician. He writes this poetry music. And he's off in a different track. He appreciates hip hop, but he doesn't want to do hip hop, and he likes the big band music and so on. So, and he's also said, well, where are we in the story of American music? You know, where are we? And anyway, remind me your question again. I'm going.
The role of music.
Yes. So the role of music. So in writing that play, thank you. In writing that play, I thought, okay, I started writing, and researching. I've researched and researched blues, jazz, Muscogean music, and so on. And I have this story idea. I've got it kind of roughly laid out. And I thought, well, how can I write without writing the music? And so for a year, I've been bogged down. I've got a turntable to do DJ stuff, and I've been writing these pieces and listening, but then I realized I have to get the story all together first. So, okay. Okay, 5 minutes. Anyway, it varies. Sometimes with Wings, the story, the music was always in there. And I first did the performance with Larry Mitchell, a wonderful guitar player. But I've started rewriting and doing some of this, like the music that was for this is stuff that the last part of it was in the show, but I can hear a track, something different that I've not heard in any play, where there's like a track of music run and sound running through the whole piece. So
another thing that I think is a strong line, that's a powerful line through your work and is very present in Wings, is identity, and is that connection to those who came before us. And you know, you speak of your grandfather in Wings. He's not a character. He doesn't necessarily come into the story and you know, step on stage and have lines that he says, but he is a presence. And so I'm just wondering if you could speak a little bit about his presence in that story and why you wrote him in there, and what it means to think about identity in that way and in our continuation of the generations in the stories that we tell today.
The way I see it, and I don't know everything, and I don't know very much, but I was a very young grandmother and a young grandmother. So I think it's helped in watching these generations and watching children grow up and people around me and watching all of us get older and older is that, but what happens is that you start opening up. I think the older you get, you start opening up and opening up. And what I've seen is that each generation is a kind of person. It's like a person. Each generation in a family, each generation in a, you know, everybody at a certain generation makes a certain coherent whole. Families make coherent wholes. So that in a family line, everybody's given a theme. There's a theme that the family works out. There's a theme that each tribe works out, works out. And in that entity, there's what's visible. I mean, there's different levels of visibility because some people see in different ways. Some of us are just taught to see the physical, and others you can see many layers. And when you look at those many layers, then you see the ancestors. And then you can see, I dreamed the other night, I saw my seventh generation grandchild, I was holding her. And it was really amazing. And I remember saying, she looks Japanese, so I don't know what's gonna happen. Yeah. Yeah. But I saw her and I held her and I thought, there I was. This is how I know these things. There I was. I was an ancestor. And maybe some of my descendants could see me and maybe not. It depends on how they were educated, perhaps. But that's how it, so my grandfather is present. They're all present. Not all of them are, some of them are troublemakers and they continue to be troublemakers, so. But they're there and they can be helpful.
And I know we're gonna have to wrap it up here, so I just wanna thank you all for joining us for this today, and please look for Wings of Night Sky, Wings of Morning Light will be coming out within the next year from Wesleyan Press, and as Joy mentioned, you know, we are trying to break that glass ceiling and get our native plays produced in, you know, just on the professional American stage, but we can tell our own stories in our own communities, and we can take our own plays and produce them in our own communities and give them to our students in our schools to read, and so I think, we're all storytellers, and you know, we don't have to wait around for the non-Indian world to say, okay, we're ready to tell your story. So thank you so much, and we'll be here the rest of the day.
Joy, I don't know what to say other than that was just incredibly powerful. And I look forward to seeing the full production, hopefully sometime soon. And I'd also like to thank Mary Kathryn Nagle. Thank you for your thoughtful interview with Joy. We wish we had more time, but maybe there'll be other opportunities for that conversation to continue in the future.